Randy's Random Rants.
An open marriage. But according to Ryan, he wasn't the only one in the relationship with a lover on the side.
She lived for a few years in Jamaica, even after they were married. And she had some kind of a male friend.
Police contact Sarika's family to corroborate Ryan's story. Sarika's family confirms she indeed had a boyfriend in Jamaica named Junior Powell. According to her family, Junior helped fill a gap in Sarika's life after she and Ryan married, but were forced to live in separate countries until immigration officials gave Sarika clearance to immigrate to the U.S. Sarika's family tells detectives that while Junior was head over heels for Sarika, he wasn't exactly thrilled with her marriage to Ryan.
I talked to him about that. It's not something that he was happy with.
Could her marriage to Ryan have finally pushed Junior to the brink? That theory seemed possible until police contact authorities in Jamaica. Turns out, Junior was in the Caribbean at the time of the murder. But if detectives can eliminate Sarika's lover as a suspect, then who committed this vicious crime? A search of Ryan's phone records reveals one possible clue.
Ryan text message to say that he's gonna initiate a divorce from Sarika.
Her testimony was inconsistent with Ryan's story.
A review of the actual text messages shows that Deidre is telling the truth. Why did Ryan lie to police when they asked if he was happy with his marriage to Sarika? Detectives begin questioning Ryan's account of the attack.
Ryan Holman says he woke up after being knocked out and went straight to the home of a resident that was nearby.
The police could never imagine just how twisted this sordid story was about to get, or the unspeakable evil that had forever severed two lives.
Don't make a sound.
Initially, police believed Sarika had died during a botched carjacking. But 24 hours into the case, the evidence is starting to point detectives in a new direction.
Ryan's story and the evidence.
For what? Under arrest.
For what?
For murder.
I didn't do anything.
The news leaves more than a few people stunned.
Man, this is stupid.
To tell you the truth, my reaction was that he was innocent. I would have bet my life that he was innocent.
I believe in Ryan's innocence because I know he didn't do it. Ryan is not the type of person.
What's wrong
with
these people?
2011, Ryan Holness is led into a Baltimore courtroom to stand trial for the death of his wife, Sarika.
What I was concerned about was the family members and making sure that justice was done for them.
Prosecutor intending that on the night of June 4th, 2009, Ryan Holness drove Sarika to a field in Crumpton, Maryland, where he stabbed her 58 times. After the murder, Ryan scattered his and Sarika's belongings and then inflicted a knife wound to create the illusion of a violent carjacking. While Ryan's mystery accomplice drove his car to D.C., Ryan disposed of the murder weapon.
We believe very strongly that Ryan Holness went to the bridge and threw that knife in the river.
According to prosecutors,
did you guys
Ryan
find
then
the
went
knife?
To the mobile home. But when nobody answered, he headed to the Rolfe residence where they called 911.
It sounds like insurance money.
After laying out the motive, prosecutors hammer away at the discrepancy between Ryan's version of events and the evidence revealed during the subsequent canine search.
The canine dog followed Ryan Holmes' scent to the bridge. It was very clear that his story was just not adding up.
On the heels of a violent attack that left him dazed and confused, Ryan simply forgot. But as prosecutors point out, if Ryan had truly survived such a brutal assault, medical records would support that claim.
Ryan Holness said that he was knocked out for several hours. Well, the doctor said there was no physical evidence that he sustained any injury to be knocked out for that amount of time.
His affairs, the damning phone and computer records, and the $1 million insurance policy Ryan took out on Sarika's life. But Ryan's defense team counters that their client's actions weren't that unusual in light of other policies Ryan and Sarika had recently obtained. McGrath turned it over to the police. The details were telling.
the information that was in the letter could only have been provided by the perpetrator.
A copy of the letter is shown to jurors, and its authenticity verified.
They brought in a handwriting expert, and it was confirmed that it was Brian Holden's handwriting.
With the confession letter in mind, the jury breaks for deliberation. Sarika's family anxiously awaits their decision.
I say to myself, Ryan, if you are the one who really killed Susie, whatever you get, deserve it.
On March 28, 2011, the jury returns with a verdict. Guilty.
We're all broken.
Sometimes I think of it as if I'm watching a soap opera or a movie. That's how I look at it. I don't think it's for real.
But Sarika's family is relieved.
They have been living with this nightmare for months and months. So to have the jury come back and determine that he's guilty on all counts was important to them.
The sentence was the final chapter in this tragic love story tainted by scandal and greed. Sarika was so enchanted with the idea of being married and living a better life in America that she couldn't see the evil lurking in the heart of the man who promised to make those dreams come true.
He's a killer. He's just a killer. He devised an elaborate scheme to kill his wife, to obtain $1 million in insurance money. And what would motivate someone to do that is just beyond me.
Well, you know, old Randy has got some things to say. Now, in this recording, this video right here, it has a little bit of the information needed to reply. But one thing that I'm missing on this video is the information that these two fools, they're from Jamaica, and they were cousins. This nigga married his cousin, this fool, and her also, both fools. They're from Jamaica. Now, one thing that I gotta say, all right, I don't criticize or try to mock or twist what I say around, because I have stuff to say about everybody. Every culture, every dynamic of a fucking character, okay? If you're a cool person, you're a good person, you're a good person. If you're not and you're an asshole, okay? Now, a lot of Jamaicans, most, and especially in Jamaica, they will literally kill you if you're like, I don't know, if you're gay, you're flaunting gay, you're flamboyant and all of that shit. Like, they will make sure that your ass gets it, okay? Except when it comes down to it, I would say that half of the American population that's gay is Jamaican. Or just Caribbean, okay? And you could argue all you fucking want. You could get mad. You could fucking come and look for me and get fucking popped. I don't give a fuck. Alright? Half of the fucking population that's gay is fucking Caribbeans. And they sit there talking about, oh, blood clot, pussy sucker, da 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 da. Listen, either you're gay or your brother's gay, your cousin's gay, or your fucking sister, somebody, one of you motherfuckers is gay. And if you're not gay, know what I'm saying? Like, they, you run from your fucking culture and all of that shit, right? And then turn around and do shit. Like, this nigga right here, If he ain't get caught, he'd be the same motherfucker talking that blood clot, pussy sucker shit. And you and I, yo, listen, I've seen it personally. I don't even want to call no names out, fucking pointing elbows or all, nothing. I've seen it personally, okay? In real life. A brother and sister. I've seen cousins, all of that shit. Incest, I've seen it, all right? But you are gonna marry your cousin? Them two, they were married, and they were cousins, okay? Now, for the jury and all of the prosecutors and the judge and all that, okay? You people need to let me be a judge. Don't let me be a judge, because I have no mercy, all right? First of all, out of all of the prosecution and all the theories and all the fucking conclusions and hypotheses and all of that shit, my question would be, why the fuck did you marry your cousin for? And who marries their cousin? And you guys are laying around screwing each other, married, sitting there fucking each other in a fucking house. And then you got side fucking relationships and all that. Like, listen, you should be locked up just for that. Fuck murder and killing and trying to fucking plot and plan and all of that shit. Fuck that. You should be locked up just for fucking marrying your cousin. This ain't motherfucking The Color Purple, nigga. The fucking color green or whatever the fuck. Motherfucker, like, get the fuck out of here. That nigga should have been locked up right away. Oh, he married his cousin? Put his ass in jail. For life. Fuck that. That's what I would give you. Life, my nigga. You come to America to marry your fucking cousin. And then, these people, they be in these other countries. All right? Jamaica, freaking Haiti, wherever, Afghanistan, Saudi Arabia, the fucking South America, it don't matter. You know what I'm saying? They look at fucking TV, right? And they're like, wow, look at that 50 Cent, look at that gold, oh, they rapping. When you come over here, what is it that you think you're going to do? You think you're going to be 50 Cent? You think that people want to hear you rapping on fucking stage? Oh, do la la do that, that. Like, what the fuck is it that you think is going to happen when you come over here? Like, you know what I'm saying? You got these, oh, yeah, they want a piece of the American dream. They want a piece of this. And then come over here, marry your cousin, and then kill her. What the f... Come on. Stop it, man. Stop. And then you're coming over here. Why? You know what I'm saying? Like, you guys can't wait to get to America. I mean, why can't you do the math? You're over there in your fucking land killing people and throwing rocks and running around with no fucking shoes on. Little kids got guns and all of that shit. Killing, robbing, stealing, all of that shit, my nigga. And you don't even notice that everybody from America goes to Jamaica. Or the Caribbeans. They want to go to where you're at and fucking look at the fucking sand. We don't want to fucking be fucking Scarface and fucking doing all of this. Like, we do fucking like crime and shit to get money so we could, like, take care of our families and fucking get the fuck out of America and go fucking visit lands like where the fuck you're from, and you're trying to leave. You're trying to get the fuck out of there to come over here to run the rat race, just so basically you can run the rat race with us to try to get away from over here and away from the fucking persecution that we got over here. And then you guys come over here with your bullshit and just fuck your shit up, fuck our shit up, everything. Like, why the hell would you want to leave beautiful sand? Even though not all of you guys live on sand and beaches, but it 30 minutes away, an hour away, for you to come a million miles from outer space to go look at the Hudson River. Go swim in the Hudson River, nigga. Go get some fish from the Hudson River. Matter of fact, go hang out in my town. Know what I'm saying? See how long you want to fucking hang out in the fucking street. how many motherfucking miles you gotta go to fucking get to where you're going, motherfucking how many jobs you can fucking get, okay? And what job you do get, like, I mean, come on, man, stop it. Stay where the fuck you're at. Don't bring that shit the fuck over here, man. I'm serious. Like, we got enough bullshit over here. This nigga married his cousin. Fucking her. Making love to her. And then turned around and murdered her. Yo, these niggas are crazy. You're out of your fucking mind. Okay?